traditional older museums have put these whales on display where they all just kind of, you know, are in a straight line and they don't really have a lot of interest or excitement.
But I want to show them doing something really interesting, because when people come and see this, it's a lot more powerful.
I can spend hours looking at the perfection of the bones and like how nature has sculpted these things. But the impact that the skeleton has on other people, I think, is really what motivates me to do this in the end. I never get tired of that.
But it takes a considerable amount of planning to figure out how to pose a behemoth-sized puzzle high up in the air. To accomplish this feat, Mike has called in a few friends with just the right tools. Next, on Whale Bones. After a humpback is born, the calf stays with their mother for about a year, nursing, learning how to feed on their own, and traveling between the winter breeding and birthing grounds and the summer feeding areas. Humpbacks are often found on their own or in small groups like this mother and calf pair. But because sound can travel much faster and further in water than it does through air, it's thought that whales that are kilometers apart might actually be in close communication with each other, which would come in handy in that first vulnerable year of life when this mother must protect her calf from one of the young whale's only predators, mammal-hunting killer whales. Not all killer whales hunt mammals, but those that do can be extremely persistent. When faced with such danger, humpback whales sometimes group up and posture towards the predators, trumpeting with powerful exhalations and using their massive barnacle-encrusted fins to ward off the killer whales. Though he bore no toothrake marks on his flukes, it's possible that defensive techniques like these helped the Calvert Island whale survive such an attack. Back at his workshop on Salt Spring Island on the British Columbia coast, Mike has been getting some help too. Now that he has finished cleaning and repairing the Calvert humpback's bones, Mike needs a way to help him visualize how the bones will come together. So he's invited a longtime colleague to his workshop. Matt Zeleny, an expert in 3D visualization, hasn't come empty-handed. He's brought not one, but three laser scanners with him. These high-tech tools will help him accurately scan all of the humpback's bones, no matter how big or small, in three dimensions. A humpback skeleton has roughly 180 bones from tip to tail, so Matt has his work cut out for him.
This is giving us an accuracy of about 0.1 millimeters. We are, however, scanning the bones in two or more setups, removing the backgrounds and combining those data sets to get the completed scan.
While Matt scans the bones on Salt Spring, a team of the Hakai Institute's mapping specialists are creating a scan of the lodge where the bones will be hung. This scan will give Mike a backdrop for his 3D bones, helping him visualize how best to fill the space and pose the skeleton. Now that Matt has all of the bones scanned, he'll head back to his office to upload the scans into 3D software.
Choosing a posture for the whale is quite a process.
You really have to think about how you're going to safely hold up all these bones and keep them together so they don't fall down on groups of school children. That becomes a real construction challenge. I've been looking at museums around the world, and traditional natural history museums had these collections of dead things, and they were all sort of lined up in drawers or hanging from the ceilings, and they all were looking like dead things. They were just catalogs of, you know, life. So that's what my first few articulations looked like. And I guess I felt a real disconnect between what I was seeing out in nature, studying these animals as they were alive, and what I was seeing in the museums of all the dead animals. And so I wanted to bring, you know, that aspect of just awesomeness, like the living things interacting in their environment, making a living, finding food, hunting and eating. And I wanted to tell that story using the skeletons, which are obviously dead, but they have this ability, if you know, display them in the right way, to tell these stories. And I think that's just so much more powerful.
I usually go back to you know, thinking about the days that I've been watching these animals out in the ocean, and I start to just sort of visualize what it could look like, what it might be doing out in nature.
And then I try to get footage or pictures doing what I want to show them doing, and then study how the body moves and that sort of thing, and sketch it.
But instead of paper and pen, Mike is drafting ideas using 3D software to come up with what will be the Calvert Humpback's final pose.
So we work with the awesome team at Camosun to adjust every bone. They rig up the digital copy of the whale so that we can move things around and the whole thing moves together. And we do that in a model of the space.
With Mike at his workshop and Matt in his office further down the coast, the two brainstorm over video conference calls.
Putting these skeletons together totally uses all the different parts of your brain, where you're really thinking about sort of the mathematical, technical side of, you know, how much does this bone weigh, and what kind of, you know, size cable do I need to support it, and then the sort of artistic side of thinking, like, how do these whales move, what are they doing, and then how do I translate that into this physical object that you're going to be displaying.
From three options, they choose the one they've dubbed the roll as the winner.
So we've got the whale in a really sort of steep rolling turn. It's bending its head back and sort of coming around to the left as it's diving down, and the flippers will be out quite a bit. I think it's the steepest turning whale that I've ever hung. It'll look like it's really moving in the space.
The dynamic pose showcases just how acrobatic and graceful these gigantic mammals can be, both above and below the water. Perfectly adapted to their watery realm, humpbacks' streamlined bodies work to reduce drag and move efficiently through the water, which is more than 800 times denser and creates 60 times more resistance than air. The bumps called tubercles on their long flippers change the flow of water, increasing lift and reducing drag, making the flippers more maneuverable. Whales have evolved other adaptations to the cold, the darkness, and the immense pressure found in the depths of the ocean. The whale's large size helps minimize heat loss, and a thick layer of blubber keeps the whales warm while acting as energy storage. Their vision is adapted to low light and is particularly sensitive to blue light, which is the type of light with the wavelength that best penetrates the ocean depths. In an environment where sound reigns supreme, humpback's ears, pinhole openings blocked by a waxy plug, are highly developed for long-distance communication and built to handle the quick and extreme pressure changes that happen during deep dives. Their nostrils, located on the tops of their heads, make trips to the surface for air quick and easy. And when they dive deep below the surface, sometimes to over 600 meter depths, humpbacks undergo a series of changes. Their heart rate slows dramatically. Blood flow to skeletal muscles practically ceases, and their lungs and thorax collapse, allowing them to withstand and travel safely through the radically different pressure exerted on their bodies at depth. But humpbacks and other modern whales weren't always at home in the cold, dark depths of the ocean. They used to be four-legged land mammals. And their earliest common ancestor is believed to be a shore-dwelling wader called Pachycetus. Living about 49 million years ago, the dog-sized animal had webbed feet and a tail. Then within the span of about 10 million years, a blink in evolutionary time, the first fully aquatic whales appeared, eventually evolving into the ocean-going whales we know today. But remnants of that early ancestor survive. Pelvic bones, and the bones of long-gone hind limbs that appear in embryos but vanish by the time a whale calf is born. And buried deep in their DNA are the lines of genetic code linking whales with their closest living relative, another four-legged wader, the hippopotamus. The Calvert humpback, survivor of ocean extremes, would have been swift and graceful as he rolled and pirouetted underwater, and will be once more once Mike is done. But without the muscles, sinews, and skin that used to contain and support his body, Mike will need to build the young whale a new framework on the next episode of Whale Bones.